So if you guys remember back, 2 weeks ago when we did rendering basics, I talked about, I basically went over a bunch of renderers that I did and a bunch of rendering engines. And I kind of wanted to introduce them to you because Rhino as a renderer is very good, but it's not the best by any means necessary. So, what are these kinds of renderers? So, we have Rhino Renderer, Flamingo, which is kind of like Rhino Renderer 2. It's better than Rhino Renderer, but it's not as good as what I'm going to show you. Then we have Lumion, Twinmotion, Enscape. So I'm actually going to show you basically like the big four in architecture rendering. This is what you're going to be kind of experimenting with over the years to see which ones you like best. So the first one is Twinmotion. This one is based off of the Unreal Engine video game engine. So it's like kind of optimized for real-time rendering. You typically get a lot of, I'm going to say the same stuff, the same thing about a lot of stuff where it's, it makes your images look good. You have access to animations. They all kind of do the same thing. It's just how they do it and their overall interfaces is what's more personalized to you. So, all these are computer generated. They're meant to be, that one looks a bit more fake just because of how the lighting works, but rendering is one of those things that it's an actual skill that you can't just get the best program, click play, and it works. It's more of you have to train yourself to be able to notice things and to kind of see things in a way that will then have your renders look a lot better. Like, these two are like incredibly fake to me, even though they look super cool and they look super nice, because you never actually see stuff like this. You guess you could, but sky being huge and pink, we see it all the time, but incongruent, there's a lot of lighting that makes it different. However, something like this is a lot better because you see a lot of that, you see a lot of atmospheric stuff. So it's something that you have to actually do over and over. I see a lot of times people won't do any renderings until the final product. I'm more of the proponent of having a real-time renderer. Like, getting a second screen is amazing. If you have any doubts on, getting a second screen, I always recommend it. I would actually, if you're here late at night, that door is always open, come and use this second screen. It's very useful. Just having a second screen to be able to look and see, because right now I can see, I can have a and I could have my real-time renderer open. Okay, so basically having a second screen means that not only can you design in the typical plan and section and even designing in perspective, but you can see how it actually feels. There's this kind of disconnect between basic geometry and how it actually feels. If I were to go over to this, which I've used as an example, a couple times the past few weeks, if I go here and I go to a rendering engine, it feels different because I can actually experience the atmosphere of it and kind of see how we like it. I can change some of the time. So I can say, okay, how does this feel at sunrise or sunset? So, and then just from here, you're not going to see this, but if I have it on my second screen, I can say, I can scale it, and then I'm okay, this is kind of a wonky looking building because I just scaled it in the vertical direction. Or maybe if I make it super thin, now we have, maybe one of those Japanese tiny homes. And just being able to because what you would see here is just your geometry, but you get a different sense of it on the second screen. or just even like if you only have one screen, I don't want to say everyone must buy a second screen. If you only have one screen, just having it up and like flipping back and forth between the model is also helpful. Like if the workflow is, okay, let me just make a change, and then I flip back to see what it looks like, and I'm like, okay, cool, I kind of like this. I can also kind of fly through. It's very video gamey. I can see things, I can walk in, and I'm in rooms, and you kind of get this like human sense of now you're actually experiencing your building. It's like the in-between between designing your building and seeing it built. It's the rendering where you can see it how it would be if it were like in a perfect world and all that. Okay, I'm just going to control Z a bit. So that's Twin Motion, even though I showed you Enscape. Lumion is another one. And all of these typically have either free trials or educational licenses. I would like everyone to get Lumion for assignment 8. I'm going to send out an announcement with the link. But basically, Lumion has a student. It has a student version, I believe, not the use. Lumion student. 2023. Yeah, so Lumion is free for students. So I always recommend it as a good starting program because technically Twinmotion, I think, looks better, but Twinmotion, you have to go a couple extra steps. It's still incredibly free, but you have to get like, so if any of you are video gamers, you might have the Epic Games Launcher on your laptop. You actually download it through Epic Games Launcher through Unreal Engine, and then you just say install educational license, and then you do your whole thing. Enscape used to be free for students, but it is not. The thing I just showed you, it is not free anymore. Big unfortunate. I was going to actually have you guys use Enscape, you know, before when I was planning out this lecture. But then, like 2 weeks ago, one of my D8 students told me that Enscape wasn't free anymore, and that it was like $12 a month, and I was like, okay, no, then use something else. You can do a 14-day free trial if you really want to. I know there have been a bunch of times where students, you know, they're doing the thing of they have their building and then they just want a good rendering program, so they just get the 14-day free trial during final seasons and just, you know, bust it out through there. But I wouldn't do, educational licenses. It's still, yeah, it's not 100% discount anymore. It's only 86, so it's like 12, I think. But yeah. And then the last thing is V-Ray. So V-Ray is what a lot of the, I don't want to call it old, what a lot of the older professors will tell you to use, because that's, V-Ray was one of the earlier ones, you know, back when they were in school or when they started teaching V-Ray. V-Ray is very good. I'm not saying it's bad. I'm just saying that I know that when I tried it, the interface was a little bit wonky, but you know, if you can do it, you can do it. Typically, like, if I just go ArcViz renderings, maybe you'll be able to, like, with experience, you might be able to tell this was made in Twinmotion or this was made in Enscape, because, like, a lot of beginner renderings in a certain program have a distinct signature or a style. But, you know, as you get more and more advanced and as you get more and more experienced, you can make renders that are indistinguishable, that you have actually no idea what rendering program that is. And I know that, and for those of you who might be kind of on the fence of architecture, I know we all are at all points of our education, there are actually studios and there are actually jobs where your job is to just make renders. Luxagon is not an architecture firm, but they are a rendering farm where basically architecture firms will send you their model, and then it is your job to just make a good image of that model, right? So your job is nothing but Photoshop and real-time renderers, so you don't have to actually like worry about design or codes. You just make stuff look pretty. There are a bunch more out there, you know, but you know, being in a career for this, yeah. Oh yeah. So when it comes to your computer, that's actually more of a trial and error type thing, where typically I found that Lumion, even though it's very light when it works, is heavy on the download. So it's a very big file. Yeah, that's when you have to actually like kind of get personal with your computer and know what your hardware specs are, because some computers might be able to do that, some computers might not. I think Enscape is the lightest, unfortunately, because it's not free. Just because if I were to like, so if I'm going to here, I can do Enscape Asset Library Browser. Unfortunately, I have to show you this just because like it's not free anymore. But you know, I can get a plant. I can say I want to place it. It says on target surface, so I have to actually make a surface. These are all meshes. So if I do that, I can do vegetation, and I can just drag and drop. I know that Lumion, like a bunch of these programs, have these props, you know, where you can just place down stuff, and if I go to the Enscape, I go over here, and here is my vegetation. So the way that Enscape is more like a plugin for Rhino, where you're not making a heavy Enscape file, you're just adding stuff to your Rhino file that is then read in Enscape. Lumion and Twinmotion, however, you're importing your Rhino model into the software and then adding models into that. So you actually have two files that you're working with. One is the rendering and then one is the actual model. So the keyword that you want to look for is live sync. So if I go to here, Lumion Rhino Live Sync. So a lot of times you might have these rendering engines that you have to like export your file in a file format and then import it into Lumion. There are often plugins that just let you, like see right here, where you literally sync up your Rhino view with your Lumion look. So Live Sync for Rhino is just a plugin. I know a lot of people who they'll download Lumion and be like, where's Live Sync? You have to remember that they make these plugins for almost every single software. So like Revit and SketchUp and Cinema 4D. Live Sync for Rhino is for Lumion. I know Twinmotion has Twinmotion has something called Datasmith. It sounds complicated just because it's called Datasmith, but it's the exact same thing, where it's just a faster way of importing your model into from Rhino into your rendering engine of choice. I can't say anything for V-Ray because I'm not actually familiar with V-Ray, but I imagine that they also have a similar thing. Let's see. Yeah. So V-Ray, I would say the least experience with, just because I tried it when I was like kind of new to rendering and it kind of confused me. So I went over to Lumion and then Twinmotion and then Enscape, and I kind of never looked back. I've always been meaning to go back to V-Ray just to learn it, but you know, Enscape for me right now, at least until my trial expires, is kind of what I use. So the cool thing about rendering engines is that a lot of times they know that you guys are trying to make cool renders. So, and you know, obvious disclaimer, this is going to be different depending on the software that you use. So in Lumion and Twinmotion, you can apply materials in the software. In Enscape, you have to, you actually import it into your Rhino. So we do Enscape material library. We now have, back, you know, when we were doing the, you know, what happened? When we were saying, okay, let's make a material and we can choose different materials. And then when we go into rendered view, you know, we might say, okay, this is, that's everything. What is this? All right, merged, whatever is my material. So we had this kind of render where we chose the materials that we wanted. And if we go over to Enscape, we can see we also have those materials on it. And a lot of times materials will be compatible with other programs, but you know, if I go to Lumion, not Lumion, Enscape, open material library, I now have a library of materials that's a lot bigger than Rhino's default, which means that this is basically how you can find materials to import. So if I wanted to go, say, MISC and do bamboo fence, I can click on this, and then the aspect ratio is weird because I have to, so you guys can't see it. Well, actually, you can kind of see it as super tiny. At the bottom right, there's an import button. I'm just clicking that to import it into Rhino. And then if I go and I just click these, let's say these are my bamboo, right? So this is my panels inner. So panels inner. And I imported bamboo fence 1 from Enscape. And in the Rhino renderer, it's going to be super metallic and super reflective, and it's not going to look correct. But in Enscape, if we move over, nothing's going to happen until I forget if there's, I'm just going to restart it. So a lot of times you might also have to just be closing it and restarting it to update lighting and materials, just because sometimes it doesn't want to like update itself. So yeah, now we have these bamboo panels that, you know, if I were to just do something like this is a really good render where we have the material, we have depth, we have shadow, we have light, you know, and I can even edit the material in the same way that we've been editing materials before, where I can change the scaling of the texture. So I'll go Enscape Material Editor, where I can now edit the material, and I can say, okay, this albedo, I want it to be 5x5, right? And then when I go over to Enscape again, it's bigger. And if I wanted to exaggerate it, you know, go 50 by 50. Now we have just these giant bamboo, you know, panels. And the picture gets, you know, super super crunchy just because it's a texture that we're trying to stretch real big. But even from a distance, you can't really tell. So now you get a lot more definition in that. So that's kind of like my intro to rendering engines. And I just wanted to kind of go through the process of how to get Lumion. Because if you already have a rendering engine of choice, like you've done it before, you can use your own. But I just want to do a walkthrough of how to get Lumion, because I'm also kind of probably going to get it myself just to kind of do a walkthrough and teach you guys how to use Lumion. So we would do get Lumion student. And then, so in order to get to the page of Lumion student, let's just Google Lumion student, Lumion for education, free for students and educators. Let's do get Lumion student. You can also do check your system requirements. I recommend that a bunch just because system requirements, this is when we think about what is our graphics card memory? What is our operating system? Our CPU. So actually, does anybody notice something that that is kind of important when it comes to should you get this rendering engine or not? When you kind of look at, when you look at this list, right? Anybody notice something that might be an issue? Huh? Which one? The operating system. So this is kind of back to, you know, every time I talk about this, I'll always go over it. I'm a big Mac slanger, where if you have a Mac, I don't want to say, like, get a Windows computer. There are ways of putting Windows on a Mac computer so that you can use all these programs. But if you're ever in the market for a new computer, a new laptop, always go Windows, because Lumion only uses Windows. I imagine that there's, like, if you Google how to use Lumion on iOS, can you install Lumion on a Mac? No. And, you know, there's no plans. So I think it's Parallels. Interesting. So maybe I won't make it required then, just because you can't do this. Does twin motion work? Hold on. Twin motion on iOS, actually, twin motion hardware requirements. Yeah, so TwinMotion 2, Windows 10 or 11, like, maybe then if you have iOS, I'll just say use the Rhino renderer, because that should still work, because we have Rhino. But working on a Mac is kind of like the biggest crutch in architecture, because everything regarding, like, digital design and doing things on a computer is well-suited for Windows instead of Mac. Unfortunate, but you know, it is what it is. Anybody have any questions? Cool. So I'm just gonna continue that little walkthrough just because you know, in case you want it. So we're on Lumion Students. We Googled, you know, Lumion students, Lumion education. We do get student, get a Lumion student. So request Lumion student. Similar to how when you had to get Rhino for educational, you had to wait for people to approve you. You have to wait for people to approve you for Lumion too. So you do fill in the form. So you do, you know, United States, Florida, International University. your name, your graduation date, which I'm gonna kind of botch up, email, you know, seemingly, your birthday, so I'm just putting in a random day, April 1st, 2023. You can check this or not. Verify and continue. So verify and continue is, I guess, 1998, and then invalid because this is probably 2024. Everything else is fine. Interesting. Hold on. I'm just going to use my student email. I guess you must receive marketing communications. So then you have to sign in by your school's web portal where, you know, we sign in. I'm not going to show my password. You do the classic Duo Mobile, which never remembers me, even though however many times I check this. A little too late. You have finished verifying your student status, which is kind of bogus because I'm not a student, you know? So then what you should do is you might get an email. Yeah, you should receive a getting started email with instructions on how to download Lumion. So just follow the steps and activate a 1-year free license. You can always renew for free as long as you're still a student. Kind of funny. And then, you know, there's a whole bunch of tutorials online when it comes to specifics on how to get started with Lumion. On Wednesday, I'll be showing you guys Lumion and kind of getting you up to speed with that. Let's see. 19, 910. So just another thing about assignment 7, has anybody not kind of, I know that this was spoken about during Wednesday's class, but I didn't upload the video until, you know, this past night, but I did add a bonus page just in case nobody, like, I forgot to make an announcement, a bonus page for a realistic render of shadows. This does not have to be on a rendering engine, although if you want to do it and you want to try it out, you can. You can just use Rhino Renderer as long as there are shadows. I just wanted to make this announcement again in case, you know, people just kind of skip through the class recordings just to get to what they need to see. And I just wanted to make this announcement again of, you know, if you want bonus points, you have to do a render of your wall with shadows. And I think I have this one. I'm going to close Enscape because stuff is running. Okay, so the idea of that bonus page that I kind of went over on Wednesday is that you're going to have a shadow, so you're going to use the sun setting, and if you don't have that sun tab, you click on the gear here, and then you click on sun, and it should give you access to the sun, and if you check manual control, you can spin it around. I don't know why it's not updating here. We go to rendered view, we can spin around the sun, right? So the idea is that if your blocks have just a direct hole through them. I want to see what kind of patterns they make. You know, when you, maybe you choose your own height, maybe it's super long. But this is kind of like for showing what would happen if you go through, if the light were to, like, say during dawn, go through your breeze blocks, what would it look like? If they cannot, say you have like an internal turn, kind of reminiscent to the labyrinth. Everyone did the labyrinth project this semester, right? I forgot if that's project one or two. But if you have like an internal turn, that means that light cannot go through, because that's a choice that you might want to make. Sometimes you don't want light to go through, but you still want wind to go through. So you let it be hollow, but you have an internal curve inside of it, as if like the, like if I were to draw just a quick section, you know, if someone did something, you know, kind of like this, right? Light cannot go through it, but wind can. If that's the case, I would like to see how it looks like when you shade it from the front. So you want to see the kind of shadows, the self-shading. You see, everybody sees this here. It's not like weird on the projector, where you see the shadow of the top one on the bottom one. Does anybody not know why self-shadowing walls are better for a building? So if you don't, I kind of went over this when I did this first sun study, but basically when you have a, let's say you have just a big wall, so let's say we have our regular wall, right? This is going to get 100% of sun just whenever the sun hits it, meaning that there's not going to be any part that is hit with less sun or more sun. It's all going to be the same. But when you have a pattern on the wall, so if we look at it, I'm actually going to take a screenshot just to draw on. Actually, better idea. I'm gonna have a picture of both of these. So you're gonna learn a lot more like in depth about this during environmental systems, where you actually learn about how we design buildings and structures to be environmentally sustainable. But basically, if we think about how much sun this is getting throughout the day, this wall is going to be is going to have 100% hit all the time. Whereas this wall is going to have, like say on this piece, it's gonna have, you know, 100% hit at the top. And then on some pieces that have like no shade at all, you know, maybe at the tips here, let's see, you're gonna get like, that's not, you're gonna get like red at the tips, right, where there's kind of like no shade, right? But what you'll also see is that underneath it, when it's in the shade, it's not getting sun. So you have the bottom parts that are in the shade, and then also some of the top parts, like basically where the shadows happen, it's where there isn't sun being hit. And so whenever the sun hits something, what happens? What is the number one thing that you feel when you walk outside? Heat. So when a building gets hotter, the AC has to kick in more to cool it down, amongst other things. But when a building is hotter, that means that the cost of living in that building goes up. So when the amount that a building gets hotter by needs to be minimized, you don't want this kind of wall. So you'll still have these kinds of walls, but self-shadowing walls is kind of all the rage recently, where you have these textures that now, instead of like, you know, this being 100%,
idea
So now instead of this being 100% and that being 0%, it is now closer to like maybe 60 and 40. Also depending on the, obviously on the shape of it, on what's actually happening, but a building made up of these kinds of walls is going to heat up slower, meaning that it's going to cost less, meaning that it's much less expensive, which is good. It also means that, you know, everything in concordant to running AC is reduced, because when we run AC, we use electricity, and the more electricity we use, the more fossil fuels we burn, and it's like, it's this big domino chain of environmental sustainability, where you might say, okay, just because a building is not getting hot does not mean it's actually contributing to environmental sustainability, but it actually is, because by not getting hot, we don't have to use AC, we don't have to have other means of environmental control. We instead can put that kind of energy elsewhere. And so that's kind of why I want to see something like that, where I don't want to see the analysis, you know, you don't have to do what I just did, but I just want to see, you know, where is it shadowing, where is it not shadowing, because you have to protrude, you know, 3 to 6 inches, so it is going to cast a shadow. So I want to see that shadow in that bonus page. And I believe that should be it. Anybody have any questions? Anybody have any comments, any concerns? Then you are free to go. Good luck.